defending and the undefeated IBF welterweight champion of the world, introducing the true Arum. Let's get ready to rumble!
Welcome to the motherfucking relay. We're covering today's top boxing news.
George Groves versus Calum Smith for not only the WBA title but the Ring Magazine belt and the number one spot in the super middleweight division. Let's talk about the fight. Well, first and foremost, I gotta eat my crow again. Because I decided to go with George. I felt that, you know, both of these guys are heavy-handed punchers. Both of these guys stand a legitimate chance of hurting the other guy. But I decided to go with George because of his veteran experience, because he was coming off a very stellar win over Chris Eubank Jr. And, you know, he'd just been in there with better people. So it felt like the right choice for me. But, you know, George came up short. And as a result of that, so did I. Calum Smith was the better man on the night of the fight. Now let's talk about the fight. Let's talk about what we saw. Both men showed some very good boxing. We saw a very judicious jab from George Groves, going upstairs with it and downstairs with it.
Very good.
Very good jabs to the body. Very good hooks to the body. Hooks to the body of Calum Smith, who took those punches well, I might add.
Yes, he did.
But in hindsight, Calum Smith definitely fought the smarter fight out of these two guys. You know, Calum Smith stayed off of that front foot. He chose not to give up his height, and that was very smart on his part because in doing so, that limited George Groves' opportunities of firing a counter right hand. The kind of counter right hand that could ultimately alter the course of the fight. Essentially, had Calum Smith been a bit more aggressive, got on his front foot more, that would have gave the elusive George Groves all the countering opportunities he needed to pile up the points. But rather than doing that, Calum Smith, he fought a very smart, cautious fight. He used his height effectively. He didn't give it up. And, you know, even in the early goings of the fight, you know, I think it was in the third round, he caught George with a real hard shot. And that was an indicator that anything can happen. You know, if the wrong punch gets through,
it's over.
George might be in trouble. He had to fight his way off the ropes. I believe that was the third round. He got hit with a real hard shot. He got stunned, went into survival mode, but he fought his way off the ropes and landed a few interesting punches of his own. But in that moment, you saw that, you know, these two guys, they both have the kind of power to hurt the other guy. George, being the smaller fighter in the fight, he had to get within the danger zone to do any kind of business because Calum wasn't giving up his height and he was fighting very cautiously, fighting from the outside and being wary not to give George any countering opportunities. It was a nice, even fight for the most part, and the aesthetic overall was very pleasing. It had the feel of a real nail biter, that a single shot could ultimately change the dynamic of the fight. And we saw George get stunned at least once or twice before the knockout. Before the fight, you know, there were a lot of people, they weren't confident in George Groves' wherewithal, that even though the guy's only 30 years old, it's a hard 30 because of all the experiences that he's had. You know, he dislocated his shoulder in the last fight, and he'd gotten his jaw broke sometime before that, knocked out by Carl Froch.
Two times.
To some, he seemed like a guy who'd been through the ringer one too many times. Essentially, what I saw was there were a lot of people out there, there were, who didn't trust George Groves' physicality to hold up. That, you know what, he might be the better boxer of the two guys, but physically, he might actually be on the slide because the guy's been through a lot of wars. And it turns out that those people were right. In this instance, my take, physicality is really what failed George Groves. His punch resistance just wasn't there because there were one or two, you know, two or three times I saw George get stunned in this fight. It gave you the feeling that if George hadn't been through as much as he'd already been through, he might have took those punches better. But, you know, it just, his punch resistance really just, it didn't seem to be there for him. And George Groves himself said that he was a bit embarrassed because Calum hurt him to the body. He said he's never been hurt by a body shot. And, you know, in the final goings of the fight, we saw Calum Smith land a hard right hand to George Groves' body. And, he, you know, George said that that really took something out of him. So it seems like George Groves' physicality is not holding up. For those people out there that were weary of this, turns out you guys were right, I was wrong. I didn't necessarily view George as being durable, but I felt more along the lines of, you know, George is elusive enough that he can get out of the way of the hard shots. And you know what? That just wasn't the case. Calum Smith showed up, showed out, and he gave a career-best performance in this fight. I didn't really give him much odds to win this thing. So congratulations to Calum Smith, who is now, he's the top dog at super middleweight. You can feel however the fuck you want to feel about it. But at the end of the day, right now, Calum Smith is not only the WBC Diamond Champion, which is a baby belt, but he's the full-fledged WBA champion, and he just so happens to be holding the coveted ring belt. He is the numero uno in the division, whether you agree with it or not. And since there's a new numero uno in town, you can expect that people are going to be targeting Calum Smith from here on out. You know, the titles in the super middleweight division are still split four ways between four guys. You got David Benavidez holding the WBC. You got Zerto Ramirez holding the WBO. Jose Uzkateki, who is fighting this weekend, he's holding the IBF. And now Calum Smith's got the WBA. This is a division that needs absolution. It still needs absolution. Those titles still need to be consolidated. We still don't know who the best guy at 168 is. All we know is that out of all the guys holding belts, they're ranking Calum Smith as number one for taking out George Groves. So, and it's a big scalp. I don't want to denigrate him in any way. But what I'm saying is, I don't want him to be number one figuratively. You understand? I would prefer that the number one guy assert himself as number one by beating the other four champions. And right now, there are two undefeated champions there, not counting Jose Uzkateki. Now, I've got Jose Uzkateki winning his fight by knockout or technical knockout this weekend. Hopefully, it's not a complete wash for my picks. This is one that I got wrong. Let's see if I get the other four or five right. But the thoughts that I'm left with post-fight are, you know, 168, we need to start seeing unification fights here. It's gone on long enough. You got the four titles split four ways. Something needs to happen. Somebody needs to step up and challenge these other champions. Somebody needs to get the ball rolling for unifications. That's what I want to see most out of 168. You know, there are good fighters there. No doubt about it. There's a talent pool up there. And if you pay close attention, every single guy holding a belt is a puncher. Every single one of them is heavy-handed. So there are, there are very exciting fights to be made. I'm just left wondering, who's going to be the one to take the bull by the horns and make those fights? Now, in middleweight news.
Okay.
With the death of HBO Boxing, in the wake of the death of HBO Boxing, it appears that Gennady Golovkin is being approached by all major platforms, according to Tom Loeffler. Now, this development obviously isn't limited to Gennady Golovkin. It's limited to any fighter that was featured on that platform. And this is more or less the kind of consolidation that I was talking about. That in some ways, it's sad to see HBO go.
A little bit.
But in other ways, there's a silver lining that this is effectively consolidating.
The fighters.
You know, it narrows down how many channels you've got to watch to get your boxing fix. So in that way, it's kind of a good thing that these fighters are going to end up on similar platforms. That opens the door to new possibilities, new fights, less friction in negotiations. But particular to this, you know, that Golovkin is being approached by all major platforms. Once again, that's according to Tom Loeffler. That's an interesting development because, you know, people are already talking about Canelo Alvarez being a free agent. Who's he going to go with? There's a lot of speculation in regards to that. Some people feel he might go with Showtime. Some people feel that since there's an existing relationship between Golden Boy and ESPN, Canelo might go over there. But the thing is that, you know, it's a different situation with Canelo than it is with Golovkin. Canelo's only 28 years old. He's still a young guy. There's a lot of upside to that. The fact that he's a young guy, he's already an established pay-per-view attraction. Thus, you can imagine the kind of incentives that the networks would be willing to offer him. The networks, the platforms, what have you. Everybody that's out there. It's conceivable that they'll do what they've got to do to get Canelo Alvarez on their team. But for Golovkin, who is what, 36, 37 years old, you've got to ask yourself. And this is just me calling it down the middle. I'm not trying to be an asshole. But it's not the same investment with Golovkin that it is with Canelo because Golovkin doesn't have as much upside.
Not really.
Ask yourselves, how many more years do you guys feel Golovkin's going to still be in the sport of boxing. Given recent events...
Controversy.
You know, however you feel about the fight, what we know is that right now, Gennady Golovkin is not a champion. He's got no belts. And, you know...
Getting older.
He's an older guy. Relatively speaking, he's a bit older. He's 36, 37 years old, something like that. Put yourself in the network exec's shoes and ask yourself, what would you offer Golovkin to come over to your network or to your platform? Now, Bob Arum said that he wants Gennady Golovkin to come over to ESPN. That's a silver lining. Yeah. It's just a question of what are they going to do to incentivize that kind of a situation for Golovkin? How much are they willing to give up? It being that Golovkin is, you know, a little bit on the older side. It's a very curious situation. I mean, at this point, I really feel like anything is possible. These guys could end up anywhere. This thing could work out any which way. But one thing that caught my attention in regards to Bob Arum's comments, you know, Gennady Golovkin potentially crossing over to ESPN. One thing that Bob said that was pretty interesting is a potential fight between Golovkin and WBA regular champion Ryota Murata. That would be a fight between Olympians. I think that that fight in and of itself could draw a lot of attention. Ryota Murata is a superstar in his backyard, and that fight could be worth some significant coin. You know, it could. It's a chance for Golovkin, who's getting a bit long in the tooth, to make some more money.
Without Canelo.
With or without a rubber match.
Against Canelo.
With Canelo. You understand that there are still avenues of opportunity for Golovkin out there. And let's face it, Golovkin fought his heart out in that rematch, you understand? A lot of people feel that he won the fight. So with those things in mind, you know, yeah, Golovkin's getting older, but he's still able to compete at the elite level. So a situation between him and a young upstart like Murata, you know, Murata's not a baby or anything like that, but he's certainly younger than Golovkin. A situation between those two could be a very interesting situation. That is an avenue and an incentive for Golovkin to consider ESPN, you know, leaguing up with them, essentially. So that's an interesting component. I wouldn't mind seeing that fight. And Bob also mentioned a similar situation with Canelo, but he said that, you know, the guys over there at Golden Boy, they're experienced enough to negotiate their own situations. So if Canelo and Team Canelo, if they were interested in coming over to ESPN, he'd expect Oscar to initiate the talks. Whereas with Golovkin, Todd Dubose. The one reaching out to Loeffler, you know? So it's just interesting to see how...
It's playing out.
In the wake of the death of HBO, how all the chips are falling. You know, how is this all going to play out and how it reverberates throughout the entirety of the sport? Because, you know, Golovkin is still a big name. Canelo's a big name. Golovkin's a big name. And it's a very curious situation...
Overall.
To see, how, you know, how is all of this going to play out? Where are these guys going to end up and what effect is that going to have? I myself, like I said, the silver lining for me is less division. Less division, more consolidation, thus more possibilities. I view it as a bit of a good thing. Call me cynical or call me a wide-eyed optimist. Call me whatever you want. But I do see that this could actually have a positive effect on a long enough timeline. It could turn out to be a good thing.
Now I'll tell you that as far as where these guys are going to end up, it's anybody's guess right now. And if you want my opinion, I'd rather let the story play out than try to forecast it because...
It's fluid.
As far as I'm concerned, anything is possible at this point. The news is fluid, and we don't have any other insights aside from what's being released to the media. What information is being made available to the media?
So let it play out.
As far as forecasting where these guys are going to go, it's anybody's guess.
Right about now it is.
But in any event, regardless of where they go, I'm pretty sure it's going to have a big impact on those networks, on those platforms, and on the sport of boxing as a whole. So it should be a very interesting next couple of months as these guys decide to make their decision and find a new home.